nursing homes have been very painful for all of us, but we have 100 other facilities, adult foster care centers, assisted living facilities, senior citizen housing, where while we don't have the same indications of infection, we have the same vulnerable population. And we are very anxious to move through those 100 buildings and test all these individuals. And when Dr. Vedicuti heard about this, he stepped forward, and along with his partners at Henry Ford Health System, and John Zervos is here, who's head of the Global Health Initiative for Henry Ford, they said they would work together. And what John and his team have been doing, with some guidance from Dr. Mark Zervos, is they've been driving a lot of the testing that happened at the nursing homes, which was then taken to our 15-minute Abbott sites. They're now going to dramatically expand that operation. Between Henry Ford and Dr. Vedicuti, the seniors in the city of Detroit are going to be that much safer. With that, I just want to say thank you. And by the wonders of technology, Dr. Vedicuti is joining us here today. So, Doctor, thank you for this generous contribution.
Thank you, Mayor Duggan. It's very important to me personally. 45 years ago, I came to Detroit for my studies and career, and they've given me a lot of opportunities and build my career here. It's the least I can give it back and help the seniors, and it's very important for initiative for us on outreach and the testing and monitoring them in the mobile testing way is very important to us. So we're very excited. I mean, it's not going to stop here. I'll continue to do the support as we see more need is needed, and I'm very committed to help Detroit's senior community, vulnerable population. Thanks for partnering with us, and we're looking forward to see some good results come out of this. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Doctor. These are the kinds of partnerships that are making a difference, and now I'm going to ask if your partner, John Zervos, would like to talk about how you are working together on this project.
Thank you, Mayor, and thank you to the Vedicuti family and, of course, to the Health Department. From the beginning, our team, the Global Health Initiative at Henry Ford, has connected with Denise and Dr. Raymond and Carla over at the Health Department, really to address an urgent need of getting to our elderly residents here in the city of Detroit. Some of that work underway already, and with additional partners as well from Wayne State University. Dr. Tina Chopra and Dr. Paul Kilgore over at Wayne State have been a part of this. The EMT department has been a part of this from the beginning, and of course our teams at the Health Department and Henry Ford as well. And it's really been a phenomenal partnership in terms of academic institutions, the city of Detroit, a major healthcare system, and now the philanthropic community really coming together to address such an urgent need in the city of Detroit. The program will extend beyond nursing homes, as the mayor indicated, to really any congregate settings in which elder Detroiters are residing, starting with the assisted living facilities here in the city of Detroit. The components include both testing of residents and staff within these congregate facilities, as well as outreach. And that outreach includes both needs assessments, in which so far the city has been a phenomenal partner on that. We identify needs within these settings, and we're able to address them. We also provide education on infection control, in addition to other topics which the staff really comes to us. So now that we have some continued support, some additional support from the Vedicuti family, we're able to bring this program to so many additional people within the city. And so we really thank you for the support, Mr. Vedicuti. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, and thank you so much. We'll let the doctor get back to what he was doing, and we're going to let John get out to the senior centers and start testing. But thank you very much, sir, for your generosity. And we have more good news. Louis Pisker of Wayne Metro, the CEO, is here with us. And in the recent federal CARES legislation, there was an $11 million allocation made to Wayne Metro for Wayne County, $8 million of which is going to the city of Detroit. There was a report out of the University of Michigan today that one out of five Detroiters is concerned they may run out of money in 3 months. And this effort by Wayne Metro is our attempt to deal with that. This is support for food, support for rent, support for property tax payments, for any range of services, and it basically is for an individual who makes less than $25,000 a year or a family of four that makes less than $52,000 a year. And for many Detroiters, the fact that they are setting aside $3 million for water assistance is especially important, because our concern is this. We don't want to be in a situation when the pandemic is over that people weren't able to keep up on their payments and now we have to start another round of water shutoffs. Nobody wants to turn off anybody's water in this city, but we have to make sure the bills are paid or we won't have a system. And what Wayne Metro has agreed is that $3 million of this will be set aside for water assistance. And the program that they will be operating is they will pay $50 a month for 5 months of your water bill. So if you're now on the WRAP program or the 10-30-50 program, or as long as you're in that lower income range, if you call Wayne Metro and you qualify, they'll enroll you in the program and will pay $50 a month for the next 5 months of your water bill, which will allow you to stay on your payment plans so that as we come out of this, you don't have a big arrearage that has built up. It's an extraordinary opportunity. And I know Mr. Pisker has lined up a whole lot of people to answer the telephone because Detroiters could reach out now, and if you're below what is 200% of poverty level and you need help with your rent bill, your food bill, your water bill, your property tax bill, there's $8 million in new funding to help you. With that, I'll turn it over to the person who will be running the program, Louis Pisker.
Well, thank you, Mayor. Thank you so much for having me here today to brief residents on this opportunity for assistance. Wayne Metro, we're really proud to be the community action agency for the city of Detroit, and we are really proud to be serving Detroiters with this CARES stimulus funding. As the mayor stated, we want to get this money out to Detroiters as soon as possible. Our goal is to get the majority of this funding out between the next 90 to 120 days. And working in partnership with the city, Detroit Water and Sewer Department, Department of Neighborhoods and Housing and Revitalization Departments as well. As the mayor stated, there are six broad areas of assistance. Food and income supports, we have a major agreement with Gleaners. It goes beyond food. It is diapers, wipes, formula, hygiene kits, and anything else a family might need. We are using the existing food distribution network in the city. We have partners with 16 major nonprofits, and we are also working with 30 neighborhood-based groups. I want to preface this that all of the funding that the mayor talked about is available currently today, right now, and I'll get to a phone number and how to get to us in 1 second. If you are enrolled in the WRAP program, the Restart program, 10-30-50 program, you don't have to do anything. You will automatically get that $250 credit that the mayor talked about. Also, we have an additional $1 million set aside that we think that we want to access an additional 4,000 residents and get them not only this credit, but also get them enrolled in the WRAP program as well. Along with that allocation, there's $500,000 set aside for major plumbing repairs. So we can now get to any home that needs a major plumbing repair to get water restored. There's $1 million in rent and mortgage assistance. Please call us. Let's resolve that rent and mortgage issue before you get an eviction notice. Property tax assistance, as the mayor stated, and something new that we are launching is funeral expense assistance. We know that a lot of families here have suffered losses in the city, and we can provide up to $1,500 of funeral expense assistance, but we need people to call. As the mayor stated, there's what's called categorical eligibility, so it won't take you long to get qualified for these services. If you are currently receiving unemployment assistance, if you're enrolled in the WRAP program, if you're currently on Medicaid, if you're currently on a program for your utilities, LSP, you are categorically eligible. So it won't take you a lot of time to get the assistance that you need. So how do you get a hold of us? Our call center is up and running right now. It is 313-388-9799. Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 7 p.m., we are available. Again, 313-388-9799. You can also go to our website, Wayne Metro Cares, and you can land on that webpage and get all of the information that we are talking about today. please be patient. As the mayor stated, we have a lot of people ready on the phone, eager to take your call. But please be patient. We will get to you. There's also an online application on the website that you can ask, that you can fill out. And also we have a chat feature also on our website. So if you have a question, you can chat us and we will get back to you in real time. So we are up and running. We're ready to go. And please reach out. Thank you, Mayor.
All right. Thank you, Lewis. You're doing a great job. And for a lot of people in this city, that money is going to be really important over the coming months till we can get this economy up and moving again. We have numbers updates, and I'm going to take some time to talk about them a little bit. We have 947 of our residents that we have lost now, 200 of them residents of nursing homes, three of them nursing home staff. I know when you look at the daily numbers, it's hard to make sense of them. We reported 87 on Saturday and 9 on Sunday, and 30 today. And of course, 87 people didn't die on Saturday, and there weren't only 9 on Sunday. One of the ones that came in today was from March 18th. And so we're going to start to show this in a way that I think is understandable to the average Detroiter. So let's see if we can get our chart to come up here. And so this is on the city website. It's going to be on here from now. It lists the number of deaths each day. So when we report 87 on a Saturday, they actually were spread all through the days that occurred. But I want you to see what's happening in the city. And so on March 22nd, we had almost none. We had one death. And by March 31st, April 1st, we had 42. So we went from 1 to 40 in less than 10 days. It was a rate that was scaring everybody. It was a time at which we had 600 police officers in quarantine. As we got here, the feds and the state built the 1,000-bed TCF field hospital because it looked at the trend we were on that we were going to need that hospital. As I said to you about 10 days ago, we'd hit a plateau. That the people of this city did such a great job of honoring the social distancing requirement. And this is when Dr. Birx nationally said Detroit's results were remarkable. They all expected us to go like that, which is pretty much what all the other northern cities did. Instead, we leveled off. And about 10 days ago or so, I said we're on a plateau. Now you can see where we're going. We are trending down. There are more vacant beds on vents. There are more vacant hospital beds. And we're listing now by week the number of deaths that occurred. So you can get a sense of where we are as a city. From March 29th to April 4th, 3 weeks ago, we lost 215 of our neighbors. The next week, we lost 246, then 241. In the last week, we lost 127. It is still far too high, but this is why Detroit is attracting national attention. The speed at which we leveled this up off and brought it down. But here's the risk. When we took off in late March, it was from a base that was almost nothing. If we relax, we start going together in crowds, we start ignoring the social distance requirements, we're going to start at a base from here. And if we take off from that base, we are going to have far worse infection rates and fatality rates than we've had before. So we have to keep doing what we're doing. And I'm convinced that what Denise Fair is going to talk to you about in the nursing homes was a huge help. But the other thing is we are now starting to work through where are the other sources of infection. And on Friday I talked about the fact that I am concerned about the grocery stores as a place where people congregate, as a place where it's a potential spread of coronavirus, even if people are sheltering in place. And I have to tell you, the reaction from the grocers over the weekend was nothing short of outstanding. I've been talking to grocery store owners all weekend, and Martin Manna in particular at the Chaldean American Chamber of Commerce came forward And what they had to say was almost the same thing the nursing home owner said to us, pretty much the same thing the funeral director said to us a week ago. They said, we want to fight this. Nobody has come forward and told us how or brought us resources. They told us to keep our customers 6 feet apart. But tell us, what should we be doing? How do we get the employees tested? What's the protocol? And I'm learning the same thing over and over, that the leaders of this community, if you will just show them the roadmap, will cooperate. And I have to say, even in the last 48 hours, we've seen huge enrollment in Fairgrounds testing from Whole Foods, from Del Bene Produce in Eastern Market, from Glory Supermarket, from Mike's Fresh Market, Imperial Supermarket, Save-On, King Gold, Liberty Food Center, Avalon Bakery, and even Faygo have all been calling and enrolling people in a significant way. It's becoming clear to me that I don't think we're going to need any order. We are going to sit down cooperatively in the coming days and agree on a set of protocols, and we'll evaluate the grocery stores from there. If there isn't cooperation, we'll go to an enforcement level. But based on what I'm hearing, we have a lot of dedicated business owners who want to keep their employees and their customers safe. And so we are doing the same thing at the city, and to help the grocery store owners get started and other businesses too. We have now put out a set of safe workplace standards called the COVID-19 Safe Workplace Standards for the City of Detroit. We're going to start announcing tomorrow the different Detroit operations that are going to come back to work. But I wasn't going to bring anybody back that we didn't have to. Police, fire, EMTs, we couldn't avoid that, although what's happened with the police department is a significant national story. The way we went from 600 quarantines to one a day by really rigorous standards, the way we brought down the infection rate at DDOT has been looked at across the country. We're putting these standards in place for every single operation before we bring our employees back. This is now posted on the city website. And so our employees can look at it to see what you could expect. But if you're a private company and you want to say, nobody's told me how to do this, we didn't start out with great knowledge. We learned when our police force was infected at a rate none of us could have imagined. With Dr. Rob Dunn and the protocols he put in place, it was remarkable how fast we improved the conditions there. And so I'm going to just show you the six principles that we are using when we bring our employees back. And you can see the full details of the 28-page report. But here is what I believe that we should have in place before we bring any employees back. I have a goal that says you should be as safe in your workplace during the day as you are at home on weekends. And I know when I go into the office every day, I feel very safe because I know these protocols are being followed. And so we've got some jobs like firefighters and EMTs where close personal contact can't be avoided. But with the great majority of workplaces, I think we can make them safe for the employees. And we are actually going to measure every month the infection rate of our departments to see how it compares to the public as a whole, because I think we can do this. But here's for any employee that's going to be asked to come back in the coming weeks. First, before you come back, you're going to get a COVID-19 test to make sure that you're negative. If you're positive, we don't want you coming back. We're going to make sure you have proper medical care. So every unit, and I'll be bringing the first ones in tomorrow to talk about who's coming back first, everybody will be tested. Second, just because you tested negative the day before you came back doesn't mean you couldn't have caught it from a family member, from somebody on the street, wherever you might have gotten it. And so each day we're going to do what we do at the police department, the fire department, and DDOT today, is as you come in, your temperature is going to get taken. If you're over 100 degrees or if you express any symptoms, we're going to get you immediately to appropriate medical care. We're not going to let you onto the job site and potentially infect your fellow workers. Third, we're going to have workplace distancing. And if it's an outdoor facility running lawnmowers or patching roads, it's relatively easy to get distancing. If it's inside an office building, we're not going to bring people back sitting cubicles next to each other. Until we have proper spacing, we're not bringing anybody back in those settings. And so we're going to bring people back to a workplace only when we're convinced that workplace is as safe as it can possibly be. But we will have distancing. We're going to have mandatory use of masks and other necessary PPE. If you're in my office, you'll know everybody on our floor wears a mask when they're interacting with anybody else, because we know 10% of the city today has coronavirus, and 10% of the people across the Tri-County area have coronavirus and they don't know it, which means they're spreading it to other people. And at the beginning of this pandemic, the CDC was saying, don't wear masks. That warning has had really bad consequences for this country. Now we know, even if you believe you're well, you should be wearing a mask to protect your neighbors, and the governor has, of course, mandated it. We are going to do frequent cleanings of both the work sites and the vehicles. So our police officers know every time they drop somebody who's been arrested off at the lockup, first thing that happens is the car is washed out. The buses drivers know. At the end of every single run, they get to the end of the run, they get off the bus is clean before they get on and head back down Woodward the other direction. And we're going to have the same kind of protocols for your work settings, and we're going to make sure that there's enough of a stockpile of the masks, the cleaning equipment, the sanitizing equipment, that your place can be safe. And a person will be designated in every department to be responsible. I do not want to get a phone call that says, hey, there's no hand sanitizer in our location. There will be somebody in your department designated. If you're a private company, you may already be doing all this, and that's great. But if you're a private company and said, hey, I wish somebody would have told me, this document is on our website, and if you want to get your employees tested, we will test them for free right now by going and enrolling at the fairgrounds drive-thru. And so that's what's coming tomorrow. You'll get a chance to hear from some of the first workplaces that will be coming back. We're doing it in full consultation with the unions, making sure everybody feels good about this. I want to have the reputation that the city of Detroit has the strictest medical protocols in the country for bringing people back to work. I want every Detroit who's coming back to work to feel as safe going into their workplace as I do every single day going into the 11th floor at City Hall. We're going to do everything we can to make that possible. And to the grocers, we're going to keep working with you. And I expect before the end of this week, I'll have a session here with the leadership of the grocery industry. And we'll have a specific one of these that's tailored to supermarkets in particular, so that everybody will know, and we're going to be there for them. We're going to test their workers ahead of time. But if somebody shows up and says, I was with my sister over the weekend and I think she has it, we're going to get that supermarket employee straight over to the Abbott lab, get him a 15-minute test. We are going to back our grocers and our food handlers in a way that gives them instant help so that they can move those who are potentially infected and quarantine them. Ultimately, testing is the key to getting back to normal. We got a long way to go before we're there, but we'll get there a lot faster if we do this. And we're going to see the fairgrounds go from 1,000 to 1,200 to 1,500, maybe 2,000 people a day, until ultimately everybody in the city who wants a COVID-19 test will be able to access one. So that's what we're doing today. And with that, we promised you that this week we would give you a full report of every single one of the 26 nursing homes, what the infection rates were, what the death rates were, what Denise Fair, what John Zervos, what Dr. Rahman and the team have done is remarkable. 2,000 instant tests across 26 nursing homes in 10 days. The nursing homes now have the information they need to safely isolate those who are infectious. And I want to turn it over to the person who had that up to report on those results, Denise Fair.
Thank you, Mayor. So last week I shared that all 26 nursing home residents will be tested. I also shared that I was going to be extremely transparent and share with you the results of what we found. So if you go online right now to the Detroit website, to Detroit Health Department at detroitmi.gov/health, and click on the COVID-19 updates, and then click on the dashboard, you'll find another tab for nursing home results. So you'll find the number of positive cases by nursing home, the number of deaths, as well as the numbers that were the number of residents that were tested. Again, this is by nursing home, available now on our website. We had a chance to speak to all the nursing home directors to let them know this was coming, and they were also really supportive of us being extremely transparent. So now that we've tested all of the nursing home residents, it's time to switch gears and test the staff. Each nursing home has about 100 to 200 staff, and so we are going to utilize the state fairgrounds. We have now communicated with all the nursing directors as of 12 noon. They received a personal letter from me requiring that all nursing home residents, nursing home employees in the city of Detroit need to be tested for COVID-19 by May the 11th. So again, we're now requiring all nursing home employees to be tested in the city of Detroit by May the 11th, even if they've already had a previous negative test. And again, they can go right to the state fairgrounds. They can call the contact center at 313-230-0505. The director can call and they can get an access code, and their employees can register to get a test, again, by May the 11th. Now, I suspect that our interventions will help to slow the spread of COVID-19 because, again, these nursing home residents are in congregate settings. So it's really important for the staff to be tested. Now, the next phase of our approach is to focus more on the long-term care facilities. That's the skilled nursing facilities, the adult foster care group homes. We've identified approximately 130. And so we need to be aggressive like we were with the nursing homes and get started. So we are now in the process of prioritizing based upon the number of cases. Not only will we conduct testing, but we'll also work with the on-site nurses and provide educational webinars and provide PPE as needed. Ultimately, if COVID-19 is not addressed in these entities, it could not only adversely impact our residents, but also our staff, the neighbors, our friends, our families, of course, each other. So now let me switch gears and talk about the executive order. Over the weekend, Governor Whitmer issued another executive order to establish strategies to reduce exposure to COVID-19 for customers and employees at food and pharmacy and other establishments. So I've shared with you previously about my experiences at Detroit stores, and what I've noticed is that owners and as well as customers are taking this extremely seriously, and they have implemented measures to help keep customers safe. So I applaud those owners who are taking this seriously. From my vantage point, Detroiters are looking out for each other. They're working together to help slow the spread of COVID-19. So let's please stay vigilant and stay the course to save lives. As of today, the mayor mentioned there are 8,687 cases in the city of Detroit and unfortunately 947 deaths. As always, my sincere condolences go out to the families. So my message remains, get tested if you have symptoms, wash your hands, keep social distancing, cover your nose and mouth, and please stay home. Together we can beat COVID-19. So with that, I'll turn it over to the mayor.
Good, and I see Raj Vadakudi is still with us. I don't know if it's possible to bring Raj back up on the main screen in case somebody wants to ask him a question. I don't know if you didn't have anything else to do and you wanted to listen to us, or you were staying to answer questions, but you know, your gift to Henry Ford several years ago was transformational, and this will be too.
Okay. Opening Detroit also, we have my company, Ultimatic Employees, are contributing from all over the world, including partners, board members. Opening Detroit, again, any help you need, please let us know. We'd like to support those initiatives also. Thanks again for giving us the opportunity to support Detroit.
Is that a Michigan shape behind you there on the shelves? Oh, you got all the states of the country up there.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's right. This is actually built by an artist from Detroit in Miami in our place. This map of the country with the bookshelves here.
All right. I hadn't seen that one before. Okay, questions? Good to see you back, ML.
It's good to be back. Jim Kirchner was getting a little too much attention these days, so we're going to knock Channel 7
out of
the box. We're
going to put you at the front of the line for the antibodies test.
I'm ready. I'm ready to help anybody I can, having put this thing behind me, I hope. Mr. Mayor, ML Elric, Detroit Free Press, with all this testing that's going on, we've seen all over the country governors, mayors saying there's not enough testing material, we can't do testing. Where's the city getting all of this, and how is it that we're able to lay our hands on this when so many other people say it's one of the biggest challenges they have?
I don't spend a lot of time complaining. We just get on the phone. And BioReference Lab in New Jersey is now running 1,000 tests a day for us. Jamie Dimon and J.P. Morgan Chase were very helpful. Abbott Labs, as I think as you know, we became the first city in the country to have the 50-minute thing because their lawyer gave me the CEO's cell phone number and the FDA got approval on Friday afternoon and we had a contract signed by Sunday. And we're doing 300 there. We're close to an agreement with another company to do another 250 tests. And Boise Jackson, our procurement director, has been phenomenal. So Dr. Roberto Ribeiro specially made up 6,000 test kits for us to get us going. And now we've identified samples from around the world that are getting test kits in on a regular basis. And so we can handle 1,500 a day. But it's hard work. I spend half my day on the phone with potential sources of lab testing and potential sources of lab kits. And at this point, we're continuing to do well and want to keep expanding.
Okay. And in terms of the testing, the tests are really a snapshot in time. And as you mentioned earlier, if somebody, maybe they feel like, hey, I'm okay, and their friend's okay, and they get sick, and then 2 weeks later they start showing symptoms, are there provisions or do you envision some sort of timetable or procedure where you'll require people to be retested so that we make sure we stay on top of where they are at the present moment?
Yeah, I think a periodic retest is a good question. We're talking about now. I had mine 3 weeks ago, so we're starting to have these conversations. I wanted to make sure everybody else got tested before I got too concerned about my situation. What Dr. Dunn has done at the police department, EMS, and DDOT is this. Everybody goes through and gets tested if there's any reason whatever to be concerned. If they're negative, every single day when you walk in, your temperature's taken, but also, have you been around somebody who had symptoms? And even if your temperature's okay, if you said, yeah, I was with somebody yesterday and they were sneezing, we will send you out to get you tested, and we may quarantine you for 2 or 3 days to give it a chance for the viral load to build for the test to work. And so it isn't that you test somebody once and say they're immune. Testing starts. However, if, and I believe this is true, I believe 1 out of 10 people in southeastern Michigan have this virus. If you are at a workplace that has 30 employees and you can take those 3 out, you've made that workplace safer. Now, if you can catch the next person early, or even if you don't catch them, if they wear a mask and there's distancing, the chance of them infecting somebody else is relatively low. And so that's why we say there's 6 pieces to this plan. The negative test is an important one, but it's not the end. But I could see a day, until there's a vaccine in this country, which I believe is a year away, you could see workplaces that are testing once a month regularly. And when these Abbott machines, the kits are really readily available, or similar rapid testing, you could see people being tested in workplaces once a month. That might be happening in July or August. It'll probably take that long to get enough kits.
Given some of the regulations in terms of privacy for medical records and things like that, are these private employers providing the city with a list of their employees and you can at least see whether they've been tested? And because I'm imagining the breadwinner for a family who's stocking shelves who says, I don't feel good, but I need to go to work, so they told me I'm positive, but I need to keep working and just hope I'm I get through it.
And so the governor has extended executive orders for sick time for exactly that reason. Nobody should want anybody going to work, and no business in their right mind wants somebody going to work sick. So if you penalize somebody for telling you the truth as a business, you're not thinking very clearly. But I don't really see that as a big issue. The way it works at the city is you're going to have to show us a negative test result to come to work. And so we will not, as the employer, get the result. That's yours. But if you don't show us evidence of a negative result, you can't come in. I am going to be asking the grocery stores to go to that same process. Where they have 25 employees, we're going to want to see that their 25 employees have each come in with a negative test result. So it doesn't mean that we share the result with the employer, but it means that the employee themselves are required to show that they're negative. That complies with HIPAA laws, and I think really across the board is the way employers are going to start to handle this.
Okay, and that brings me to my next question. You'd said that you want people across the country say that Detroit has the strictest protocols for bringing people back to work. Is that for employees of the city of Detroit, or do you want that standard to apply to private employers
so
as well?
My responsibility is employees of the city of Detroit. And so my approach is very simple. I feel like given where I was at DMC during the H1N1 swine flu epidemic, in which I was responsible for the health of 14,000 DMC employees, as well as, you know, tens of thousands of patients, and it was something that weighed on my mind every day, we made a commitment then. We actually moved quickly and required you to have a vaccine to come to work at DMC that year to help head off the swine flu epidemic. And so I'm just going to set the standards for city employees. And this is going to be different. There are going to be some city employees who are working from home 4 or 5 months from now because we just can't make the workplace safe enough. There are others who could be back next week because we can. Everything is going to be driven by science and medicine. Can we make your workplace safe? And people are going to wait and see. But if employees feel like we treated them fairly and protected them, I think they'll stand up and say, the city cared about me and they watched out for me. And I think private companies, what we're doing isn't magic. It's rigorous application of the science. And Dr. Mark Zervos is here, who has helped us along with Dr. Rob Dunn. But I think private companies in Detroit should be doing the same thing. I ultimately think, and I'm not involved in it, but I think you will see the automakers and the UAW ultimately agree to the same kinds of protocols because everybody wants to go back to work, but you shouldn't have to put your health at risk to do that.
Okay, and I think this is my last question, Your Honor. I saw that first responders and DDOT employees are getting a little extra money for the risk they put themselves at by doing their job. But there are private EMS companies that also serve the city and supplement the city's EMT crews. Do you think that their employers should be considering giving them an additional supplement for the hazards that they may be facing alongside our city workers?
You know, I'm going to leave it to every employer to make their own decision. Last week you heard Muhammad Kazi talk about it, the nursing homes paying a premium to those workers who work the COVID-19 floors. You've seen a number of private companies do this, and so it's not my place to tell you what to pay individuals. My attitude is this. I can go to work every day in an environment that is safe, and I don't have random members of the public who haven't been screened coming up continually, as a police officer does, as a firefighter does, as a bus driver does. And so I felt like people who were subjected to that higher risk, even though I think we have them well protected, deserved hazard pay during the shelter in place. I think other workers who have to deal with their coworkers but don't have that continual flow of private citizens they're closely interacting with, we didn't do that. And so I can't tell you exactly where the line is, and I'm not trying to tell other companies what to do. That was my rationale for why the city did it.
Okay, but it sounds like that you wouldn't encourage these service providers to do something in the same way you encourage the grocers to either get serious about this or face
you know, I think
face consequences.
I don't I don't know enough about what their compensation structure is or anything else to be giving them advice. We don't pay them for that service. They bill the medical providers, and that's entirely a private operation. I just don't know enough about what their compensation is to give you a reaction to it.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Larry Sproul with WDIV. Mayor Duggan, obviously we're seeing that the social distancing is working, and there has been, over the weekend, we have noticed that there's been a beauty supply store is open.
Not for long. Well, DPD got out there pretty fast, as far as I could tell.
I saw one this afternoon. That's why I was...
Okay. I'd like to... If you tell me where, I'll be... Chief okay. Craig, I'm really pissed if he didn't get it shut down right away. Because when these beauty supply places have been opening, we've had people calling DPD immediately, and DPD calls me when they're shutting them down. But this is nonsense. They should not be open. And DPD, as far as I know, is dealing with it decisively. If you know one we haven't gotten to, I'd like the address after this because we'll get them right out there.
Thank you.
But anybody who sees somebody illegally, just call the police department. Believe me, when you've had more than 200 members of your department test positive for COVID-19, you have no sympathy for people who are clustering crowds and spreading that disease in this community. The Detroit Police Department is really committed to enforcing social distancing. For them, it's very personal.
Thank you.
But Larry, are you going to give John the address? Okay, good.
Okay, we have a few questions from reporters who are monitoring from off-site today. One is from the New York Times wants to know if the city defines congregate facilities the same as the state does, as in adult daycares, long-term care, et cetera, and curious as to what's included in the 100 buildings that are going to be tested.
I'll leave it to Denise or John.
Sure. So we do follow the state's guidelines. So the congregate settings or the communal settings or what we call long-term care facilities does include SNFs, which are skilled nursing facilities, adult care facilities, group homes, and I believe mental health facilities are included. So far, we've calculated approximately 130 of those facilities that fall under the congregate settings.
Okay. Question for Mr. Prisker for Wayne Metro. Reporter wanted to know if there is a household limit on the amount of assistance that a family can get.
No, there's not.
Okay. Mayor, this is from WWJ. Reporter Ron Dewey's been talking with State Rep Sherry Gay-Dagnogo, who says that the city was not prepared for the COVID crisis and wants to know your thoughts on that, and also that there wasn't enough thought given to hospital capacity in advance in case we became a serious hotspot.
Well, I know Representative Gay-Dagnogo lost her sister, and I know the pain of losing a family member in the midst of this, and my thoughts are with her. But, you know, we have to ask, I ask every day, did I do enough early enough? This country has lost 56,000 of our citizens, more than twice as many as any other country, even though it started in Asia and Europe. And how did we lose so many? And I think everybody at the federal level, the state level, the county level, the city level, doctors, scientists, hospitals, are all asking, could we have done more? The thing that will always affect me are these 200 deaths in the nursing homes. We were the first in the country to get the Abbott 50-minute test, and we went out and tested all 2,000 nursing home residents to get an immediate turnaround so that the nursing home staff could isolate them. Had the Abbott kits been approved a month earlier and we had rapid testing in this country a month earlier, I think lives would have been saved. And I think when this is all said and done, we're all going to have to ask, did we do as much as we could have done as early as we could have done it?
Okay, and one additional question she had, or observation, was that she wants Detroiters all to be tested. I know you've spoken to that before.
Right. I mean, that's our goal. But, you know, I don't spend a lot of time talking about it. I don't spend time complaining about it. We just go out and do it. And we had the first testing in Michigan that was done for people without prescriptions. For a period of time there, I think the city of Detroit was doing a third of all the tests in the city. But right now, If you're required to go to a job anywhere in the city, you can get in and get tested for free. And when we run through the essential workers, we are going to expand it to everybody. As you heard, we're going through every single senior center and group living center in the city where our most vulnerable populations are. We aren't waiting for them to come out to the fairgrounds. We're going into these centers, taking the swabs, and then testing them. And Phil Levy from Wayne State University is out doing mobile stops at a number of sites in coordination with us to try to get the outreach even further. So Michigan has lagged behind a number of the states in the testing available, but in Detroit, we've been leading the way in the state, and I'm going to keep pushing until everybody in the city who wants a test can get a test.
Regarding the tests that are going to be done at the 130 or so assisted living facilities, are these the rapid tests, like the 15-minute tests, or
no.
Another?
No, but we now are getting 48-hour turnaround time out of BioReference Lab in New Jersey. So what we will be doing is testing basically 200 people a day in different senior settings and getting them back. So we don't have the same kind of high infection rates that we saw at the nursing homes. If we do run into a place that has a very high infection rate, we can always bring it in and do it, you know, the 50-minute test and bring it back. But we're going to roll through this city in a way that balances, in every case, we're balancing the need for, do you need to know this in 50 minutes or is 2 days enough? And our doctors are prioritizing each one of those.
Okay. Earlier you had mentioned the U of M study that talked about the concerns that many Detroiters have about running out of money. Crane's Detroit Business wanted to know if you had any additional thoughts on that, if you had a chance to see the study yet.
No, I mean, you know, 33% of the people in the city of Detroit lived in poverty before this hit, and we're looking at depression-level unemployment. So Detroit's being hit hard, but we're fighting back, and people have been enormously supportive in food donations all across this city. We've had really historic commitments on keeping water on. We've had people like Bedrock who have deferred rent to small businesses to keep them afloat. A lot of people are pitching in, and now with Wayne Metro having another $8 million in assistance, we're going to do whatever it takes to protect our citizens until people get back to work.
Okay, and last question from an offsite reporter is wanting to know if there are any significant updates as it relates to the homeless population and the efforts there.
Yeah, that continues to be a great success. We are we're continuing to have the nurses visit our homeless population, not just in the centers, but now we're starting to outreach onto the streets. And we are seeing homeless infection rates really as low as the rest of the community. It's what Arthur Jemison, Donald Rencher, and the team have done, Salvation Army, Detroit Rescue Mission. This is what, you know, I think this will end up being something that gets a lot of national attention. But they went in early, checked temperatures early, separated people with high temperatures until they could get them tested. When they did test positive, moved them to a COVID-19 setting where they got proper treatment. You know, a lot of times our homeless are forgotten. But in the city of Detroit, it was really a remarkable effort by our housing department. Making up for lost time.
I missed you guys. ML Elric, Detroit Free Press. Chief Fair, I had a question for you regarding testing of workers at the nursing homes. Were they tested at the same time as residents, or some were tested and not all? I mean, can you explain to us Sure. Who got those tests in addition to the residents?
Sure. So we tested 2,036 residents. We tested about approximately 100 or so staff. And so we have a long way to go because, again, there's at least 100 to 200 staff per nursing home, and so we have made now available to every staff the opportunity to go to the state fairgrounds to get tested. So we did attempt when we went to each nursing home to ask if staff were interested in being tested, tested about 100 people or so.
And how were those 100 chosen, just by volunteering, or did somebody look like they probably might be ill?
Yeah, so we worked really closely with the nursing directors. It depended upon who was available at the time. Remember, nursing home residents or nursing home settings is 24/7. So it's really based upon availability. But again, we've now made an opportunity for all of the staff to be tested at the state fairgrounds.
We're working with the nursing home directors to get all of the staff tested, and there have been huge numbers have already been scheduled to the fairgrounds. So the folks, and you can understand it, wanted to segregate their patients appropriately first. But now I think they're completely cooperative in getting their employees tested.
And do those Abbott machines go on site, or do you take the test and
no.
go back
so
to
we,
a central place?
Yeah, so I've learned more than I ever wanted to know. But as long as you swab and put it in a dry plastic bag and put it in the machine within 24 hours, it works just fine. And so what we had done was go into the nursing homes and basically swab in the afternoon and then stay late into the night, test, and give the nursing home the results the next day.
Okay, thank you very much.
Any other questions? All right. Thank you all very much. Senior citizens. The 200 deaths that we have experienced at the nursing homes have been very painful for all of us, but we have 100 other facilities, adult foster care centers, assisted living facilities, senior citizen housing, where while we don't have the same indications of infection, we have the same vulnerable population. And we are very anxious to move through those 100 buildings and test all these individuals. And when Dr. Vedicuti heard about this, he stepped forward, and along with his partners at Henry Ford Health System, and John Zervos is here, who's head of the Global Health Initiative for Henry Ford, they said they would work together. And what John and his team have been doing with some guidance from Dr. Mark Zervos is they've been driving a lot of the testing that happened at the nursing homes, which was then taken to our 15-minute Abbott sites. They're now going to dramatically expand that operation. Between Henry Ford and Dr. Vedicuti, the seniors in the city of Detroit are going to be that much safer. With that, I just want to say thank you. And by the wonders of technology, Dr. Vedicuti is joining us here today. So, Doctor, thank you for this generous contribution.
Thank you, Mayor Duggan. It's very important to me personally. 45 years ago, I came to Detroit for my studies and career, and they've given me a lot of opportunities and build my career here. At least I can give it back and help the seniors, and it's very important for, initiative for us on outreach and the testing and monitoring them in the mobile testing way is very important to us. So we're very excited. I mean, it's not going to stop here. I'll continue to do the support as we see more needed. And I'm very committed to help Detroit's senior community, vulnerable population. Thanks for partnering with us, and we're looking forward to see good results come out of this. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Doctor. These are the kinds of partnerships that are making a difference. And now I'm going to ask if your partner, John Zervis, would like to talk about how you are working together on this project.
Thank you, Mayor, and thank you to the Vaticuti family and, of course, to the Health Department. From the beginning, our team, the Global Health Initiative at Henry Ford, has connected with Denise and Dr. Rahman and Carla over at the Health Department, really to address an urgent need of getting to our elderly residents here in the city of Detroit. Some of that work underway already, and with additional partners as well from Wayne State University. Dr. Tina Chopra and Dr. Paul Kilgore over at Wayne State have been a part of this. The EMT department has been a part of this from the beginning, and of course our teams at the Health Department and Henry Ford as well. And it's really been a phenomenal partnership in terms of academic institutions, the city of Detroit, a major healthcare system, and now the philanthropic community really coming together to address such an urgent need in the city of Detroit. The program will extend beyond nursing homes, as the mayor indicated, to really any congregate settings in which elder Detroiters are residing, starting with the assisted living facilities here in the city of Detroit. The components include both testing of residents and staff within these congregate facilities, as well as outreach. And that outreach includes both needs assessments, in which so far the city has been a phenomenal partner on that. We identify needs within these settings, and we're able to address them. We also provide education on infection control, in addition to other topics which the staff really comes to us. So now that we have some continued support, some additional support from the Vaticuti family, we're able to bring this program to so many additional people within the city. And so we really thank you for the support, Mr. Vaticuti. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, and thank you so much. We'll let the doctor get back to what he was doing, and we're going to let John get out to the senior centers and start testing. But thank you very much, sir, for your generosity. And we have more good news. Louis Pisker of Wayne Metro, the CEO, is here with us. And in the recent federal CARES legislation, there was an $11 million allocation made to Wayne Metro for Wayne County, $8 million of which is going to the city of Detroit. There was a report out of the University of Michigan today that one out of five Detroiters is concerned they may run out of money in 3 months. And this effort by Wayne Metro is our attempt to deal with that. This is support for food, support for rent, support for property tax payments, for any range of services, and it basically is for an individual who makes less than $25,000 a year or a family of four that makes less than $52,000 a year. And for many Detroiters, the fact that they are setting aside $3 million for water assistance is especially important. Because our concern is this. We don't want to be in a situation when the pandemic is over that people weren't able to keep up on their payments and now we have to start another round of water shutoffs. Nobody wants to turn off anybody's water in this city, but we have to make sure the bills are paid or we won't have a system. And what Wayne Metro has agreed is that $3 million of this will be set aside for water assistance. And the program that they will be operating is they will pay $50 a month for 5 months of your water bill. So if you're now on the WRAP program or the 10-30-50 program, or as long as you're in that lower income range, if you call Wayne Metro and you qualify, they'll enroll you in the program and will pay $50 a month for the next 5 months of your water bill, which will allow you to stay on your payment plans so that as we come out of this, you don't have a big arrearage that has built up. It's an extraordinary opportunity. And I know Mr. Pisker has lined up a whole lot of people to answer the telephone because Detroiters could reach out now, and if you're below what is 200% of poverty level and you need help with your rent bill, your food bill, your water bill, your property tax bill, there's $8 million in new funding to help you. With that, I'll turn it over to the person who will be running the program, Louis Pisker.
Well, thank you, Mayor. Thank you so much for having me here today to brief residents on this opportunity for assistance. Wayne Metro, we're really proud to be the Community Action Agency for the City of Detroit, and we are really proud to be serving Detroiters with this CARES stimulus funding. As the mayor stated, we want to get this money out to Detroiters as soon as possible. Our goal is to get the majority of this funding out between the next 90 to 120 days. And working in partnership with the city, Detroit Water and Sewer Department, Department of Neighborhoods and Housing and Revitalization Departments as well. As the mayor stated, there are six broad areas of assistance. Food and income supports, we have a major agreement with Gleaners. It goes beyond food. It is diapers, wipes, formula, hygiene kits, and anything else a family might need. We are using the existing food distribution network in the city. We have partners with 16 major nonprofits, and we are also working with 30 neighborhood-based groups. I want to preface this that all of the funding that the mayor talked about is available currently today, right now, and I'll get to a phone number and how to get to us in 1 second. If you are enrolled in the RAP program, the Restart program, 103050 program, you don't have to do anything. You will automatically get that $250 credit that the mayor talked about. Also, we have an additional $1 million set aside that we think that we want to access an additional 4,000 residents and get them not only this credit, but also get them enrolled in the RAP program as well. Along with that allocation, there's $500,000 set aside for major plumbing repairs. So we can now get to any home that needs a major plumbing repair to get water restored. There's $1 million in rent and mortgage assistance. Please call us. Let's resolve that rent and mortgage issue before you get an eviction notice. Property tax assistance, as the mayor stated, and something new that we are launching is funeral expense assistance. We know that a lot of families here have suffered losses in the city, and we can provide up to $1,500 of funeral expense assistance, but we need people to call. As the mayor stated, there's what's called categorical eligibility, so it won't take you long to get qualified for these services. If you are currently receiving unemployment assistance, if you're enrolled in the RAP program, if you're currently on Medicaid, if you're currently on a program for your utilities, LSP, you are categorically eligible. So it won't take you a lot of time to get the assistance that you need. So how do you get a hold of us? Our call center is up and running right now. It is 313-388-9799. Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 7 p.m. we are available. Again, 313-388-9799. You can also go to our website, Wayne Metro Cares, and you can land on that webpage and get all of the information that we are talking about today. Please be patient. As the mayor stated, we have a lot of people ready on the phone, eager to take your call. But please be patient. We will get to you. There's also an online application on the website that you can ask, that you can fill out. And also we have a chat feature also on our website. So if you have a question, you can chat us and we will get back to you in real time. So we are up and running. We're ready to go. And please reach out. Thank you, Mayor.
All right. Thank you, Lewis. You're doing a great job. And for a lot of people in this city, that money is going to be really important over the coming months till we can get this economy up and moving again. We have numbers updates, and I'm going to take some time to talk about them a little bit. We have 947 of our residents that we have lost now, 200 of them residents of nursing homes, three of them nursing home staff. And I know when you look at the daily numbers, it's hard to make sense of them. We reported 87 on Saturday and 9 on Sunday, and 30 today. And of course, 87 people didn't die on Saturday, and there weren't only 9 on Sunday. One of the ones that came in today was from March 18th. And so we're going to start to show this in a way that I think is understandable to the average Detroiter. So let's see if we can get our chart to come up here. And so this is on the city website. It's going to be on here from now. It lists the number of deaths each day. So when we report 87 on a Saturday, they actually were spread all through the days that occurred. But I want you to see what's happening in the city. And so on March 22nd, we had almost None. We had one death, and by March 31st, April 1st, we had 42. So we went from 1 to 40 in less than 10 days. It was a rate that was scaring everybody. It was a time at which we had 600 police officers in quarantine. As we got here, the feds and the state built the 1,000-bed TCF field hospital because it looked at the trend we were on that we were going to need that hospital. As I said to you about 10 days ago, we'd hit a plateau that the people of this city did such a great job of honoring the social distancing requirement. And this is when Dr. Birx nationally said Detroit's results were remarkable. They all expected us to go like that, which is pretty much what all the other northern cities did. Instead, we leveled off. And about 10 days ago or so, I said we're on a plateau. Now, you can see where we're going. We are trending down. There are more vacant beds on vents. There are more vacant hospital beds. And we're listing now by week the number of deaths that occurred. So you can get a sense of where we are as a city. From March 29th to April 4th, 3 weeks ago, we lost 215 of our neighbors. The next week, we lost 246, then 241. In the last week, we lost 127. It is still far too high. But this is why Detroit is attracting national attention. The speed at which we leveled this off and brought it down. But here's the risk. When we took off in late March, it was from a base that was almost nothing. If we relax, we start going together in crowds, we start ignoring the social distance requirements, we're going to start at a base from here. And if we take off from that base, we are going to have far worse infection rates and fatality rates than we've had before. So we have to keep doing what we're doing. And I'm convinced that what Denise Fair is going to talk to you about in the nursing homes was a huge help. But the other thing is we are now starting to work through where are the other sources of infection. And on Friday I talked about the fact that I am concerned about the grocery stores as a place where people congregate, as a place where it's a potential spread of coronavirus, even if people are sheltering in place. And I have to tell you, the reaction from the grocers over the weekend was nothing short of outstanding. I've been talking to grocery store owners all weekend, and Martin Manna in particular at the Chaldean American Chamber of Commerce came forward, and what they had to say was almost the same thing the nursing homeowner said to us, pretty much the same thing the funeral director said to us a week ago. They said, we want to fight this. Nobody has come forward and told us how or brought us resources. They told us to keep our customers 6 feet apart. But tell us, what should we be doing? How do we get the employees tested? What's the protocol? And I'm learning the same thing over and over. That the leaders of this community, if you would just show them the roadmap, will cooperate. And I have to say, even in the last 48 hours, we've seen huge enrollment in Fairgrounds testing from Whole Foods, from Del Bene Produce in Eastern Market, from Glory Supermarket, from Mike's Fresh Market, Imperial Supermarket, Save-On, King Gold, Liberty Food Center, Avalon Bakery, and even Faygo. Have all been calling and enrolling people in a significant way. It's becoming clear to me that I don't think we're going to need any order. We are going to sit down cooperatively in the coming days and agree on a set of protocols, and we'll evaluate the grocery stores from there. If there is a cooperation, we'll go to an enforcement level. But based on what I'm hearing, we have a lot of dedicated business owners who want to keep their employees and their customers safe. And so we are doing the same thing at the city, and to help the grocery store owners get started and other businesses too. We have now put out a set of safe workplace standards called the COVID-19 Safe Workplace Standards for the City of Detroit. We're going to start announcing tomorrow the different Detroit operations that are going to come back to work. But I wasn't going to bring anybody back that we didn't have to. Police, fire, EMTs, we couldn't avoid that. Although what's happened with the police department is a significant national story. The way we went from 600 quarantines to one a day by really rigorous standards, the way we brought down the infection rate at DDOT has been looked at across the country. We're putting these standards in place for every single operation before we bring our employees back. This is now posted on the city website. And so our employees can look at it to see.
In terms of how and when those guidelines are put out over the course of the next few weeks. And so that was something else we wanted to preview. Again, tomorrow we'll be having that first digital roundtable and inviting people in to participate in that. We're also pleased as well that we made some progress over the course of the last number of days. As you know, I'm apt to remind you of all the N95 masks, procedure masks, and other PPE that we've procured. We have distributed some 43.7 million N95 masks to date in the state of California. We have also distributed roughly 3 million procedural masks, or rather 4 million, excuse me, procedural masks. Over the course of the weekend, we were able to procure 3.1 million additional procedure masks. So we'll go from 4 to over 7 million masks that will be distributed. That's very good news, very encouraging news. It's the first large shipment from a new commitment that we had announced a few weeks ago in the state of California. It came in on Saturday. It's in our warehouse yesterday. It's being distributed today and through the rest of the week to critical needs all up and down the state of California. So real progress in that space as well. And again, it's progress, it's data guided by these six indicators that will determine how quickly we toggle back, how quickly we make these modifications. Again, that's why it's just so important that we continue the physical distancing. We appropriate ourselves in public by putting on face coverings when we are in contact or proximate to other people, and make sure that we continue to advance our stay-at-home orders. I get the data, by the way, every morning. We have a dashboard that's provided on